Welcome to Tower Talk Business Radio, where we bring you conversations with the top business minds on Long Island and around the nation every week. Featuring expert consultants and small business owners who have found success but are also willing to share their top tips, failures, and give gritty, matter-of-fact advice based on their firsthand experience. Now, let's get down to business on Tower Talk Business Radio on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Hello, and welcome to Tower Talk Business Radio, powered by the Nassau Community College Foundation. My name is Ray Schwetz, AVP of Community Relations at Jovia Financial Credit Union, along with Donyshia Boston-Hill, CEO, Keeper of the Brand, Marketing and Digital Agency. And we're focused on being the premier resource for business and entrepreneurship.
We bring you weekly advice, tips, tools, and services that help you grow your business. We interview the top business leaders in the industry. And I'm really excited about this week because it's all about connection.
Oh, yeah. Definitely connection. Helping provide us with business empowerment today is Brendan Ivory of CardConnect. Now, Brendan, tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you get started in your business? And tell us a little bit about your business, what CardConnect is.
Sure. Well, first, thank you for having me. It's my privilege to be here with you guys. I started in the merchant service industry coming from the financial planning world. Born and raised in Long Island, I went to Sachem High School, went on to Villanova and got a bachelor's in finance and immediately went into financial planning. And while I was there, I just through networking and meeting with people, I came across a gentleman who owned a merchant services business. And I was really intrigued by the idea of handling these transactions. It's something I always thought just a bank did and didn't really understand there was an industry behind it. And it just clicked. It's one of those things where you just, the numbers, I'm good with math in my head, and it just clicked. And I'm off and running in merchant services. I never even knew it was an industry at the time. And now, of course, I've been at it for, 15 years now.
That's quite a journey.
Yeah. We do love it. It's sort of it's a passion of ours. It's really nice that I know thousands of business owners in every category. It can be helpful in many ways.
There's a lot of competition in that area. I'm a banker, so banking is a very competitive industry. Merchant services, very, very competitive. So tell us, how do you handle your competition and what should businesses really look for when they're looking at merchant services?
Merchant services as a whole does not have a sparkling reputation in the eyes of the merchants. They find that they're usually set up by someone they've never met or someone who's behind a brick wall in some institution, and they've got no personal touch. So the difference that we like to think of is if you're in business and you're looking at a merchant service provider, I would choose someone that you think is going to be available and provide good customer service. When everything is working and you don't need somebody, that's not really where the issues lie. If something goes wrong, something goes awry, you want to be able to call on someone and get an answer promptly, especially your business is relying on it. And these days, every business is, they used to be maybe 10% credit cards. Now it's 90% credit cards. People are moving away from cash, so it's all the more important. So I would say that the thing to look for is someone who you can really rely on to answer your questions and get you help if you need it.
What differentiates your business from all the other guys that are out there? Is it personality? Is it relationships? Tell us a little bit about that for you.
Well, I like to think that we provide top-notch customer service. We are readily available 24/7. We provide several layers of customer service. First and foremost would be our immediate local team, our office in Smithtown. You call us, we're going to answer. You're not stuck in a phone tree. We, of course, have that phone tree behind us, the 800 24/7 number that's at a call center, all domestic support. So we do have that added layer of our local presence here as well. Of course, probably me personally, maybe half of my business is not local. We work with merchants across the country, but they all have my mobile number. I get texts with questions. Of course, you always have your email handy. So we're just readily available to answer questions. The worst thing that can happen is someone who has a business moving moment with their merchant account and can't get a prompt answer. That's the quickest way to lose a customer, quickest way to lose a client. So we try to provide that level of service that really is a differentiator. Beyond that, from a technical standpoint, we like to think our product is the best on the market. Again, having been in the industry for 15 or 16 years now, I work with a long list of credit card processors. And from that long list of credit card processors, CardConnect provides, I think, the best overall tool. They've got something called CardPoint, which is their online portal to your merchant service account. When you use your credit card terminal with them, as soon as you run the transaction, that transaction is available online in CardPoint. And you go into CardPoint to, you can also process transactions from your computer. You do your PCI compliance. You can email your customer receipt. You can go back 6 months and pull up someone's transaction. There's just thousands of little ways to make your business life easier with regard to your merchant account that not other providers offer that. And that's included when you get the account. It's just a couple dollars a month. It's really an amazing value.
With everything that's going on, I assume, I know for myself, I'm much more comfortable handling credit card transactions and cash, you know, with COVID. Yeah. And so what is it, and businesses are obviously, are obviously very negatively impacted. And, now that things are opening up, things are getting a little better. But what kind of things are you seeing out in the market, for businesses and what's helping them?
Well, certainly the biggest shift in the most recent past I've seen is people moving towards contactless payments in one way, shape, or form. So no one wants to be face-to-face. No one wants to put their credit card out there. So contactless payments, your Apple Pay, Google Wallet, et cetera, people paying with now your credit card, you could just tap and go, that type of transaction. So we provide equipment that handles contactless payments. We also have another service we use through an outside provider where we actually are able to very quickly and inexpensively enable any business to process credit card transactions through their website and even provide them with an app. So to give you a great example, if you've got a local deli with a very strong following, they can actually provide a free app to their customers. So the customer could just go on the app and order their food through a branded app for that local deli. And it's pretty amazing because what it does is as everyone is shifting from walking into the deli, ordering, waiting for their sandwich, when they're shifting from that to calling it in, these delis, they only have one, two, maybe three lines. They're getting a busy signal. So it's impeding not only the person is now stuck on the phone taking orders, which takes forever, and there's errors and maybe a language issue, or someone makes notes and writes down extra mayo instead of no mayo, et cetera. When you have this all done through an online portal like an app, it's mistake-proof. It takes absolutely no personnel, and the orders just pop up on a screen in the deli, and the money just is rolling through the app because people are paying by credit card anyway. So someone walks in, picks up their order, and leaves. And it's just super time efficient, obviously contactless, which is what everybody is looking for these days.
Absolutely. And I think at the beginning, at the top of 2020, everyone kept saying, I thought we were going to be living in a Jetson stage, And it sounds like, just based on life, we were pushed into technology. So contactless technology that you're presenting is definitely timely. And people had to pivot. So your clients pivoting and what challenges and pivots have you as a business pushed through?
Well, I've noticed our clients who were very hesitant to adopt technology in the past have seen the writing on the wall and very quickly begun to take those steps that they need to take to adopt whatever measures it is, whether it be accepting credit cards when they didn't before or having some online presence, et cetera. On our side, we've tried to stay ahead of that curve and know what the people are going to ask for and have it available before they ask. So certainly contactless is one of them. Being able to process through a website, et cetera, is another. The other thing that we've gotten a lot of demand on is a new program where when you use a credit card, when you offer credit cards, you pass the fee along to the customer. So that's been becoming more and more popular in the last 2.5-3 years anyway. But when all these businesses absorbed really like a big hit from not being able to be open or being open in some limited fashion, and also all of their business becoming credit card business, not cash, they've become more apt to want to pass the fee along to the customer because it now represents, you know, 98 to 100% of their income is credit cards. They don't want to absorb all those fees any longer. So that's been a big trend as well.
Yeah. You know, I think before, you know, people were hesitant because they don't want to, the competition may not be passing it along, and now everyone.
Right. Now everyone. Yeah. And so we've been very, very much involved in that. Even 2-3 years ago, we started really before anybody was doing that locally. We're only gas stations were really passing the fees along. There's two prices at a gas station, same program. So we've been offering it for quite some time, but now it's like, you know, I would say half of our questions are about that and contactless. Every question is contactless, but also they want to be able to pass the fee along.
Absolutely. It's become the norm. That's fantastic. Mm-hmm.
You are listening to Tower Talk Business Radio on the voice of Nass Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm Ray Schwetz, along with Donyshia Boston-Hill, and our guest today is Brendan Ivory of CardConnect. You mentioned something before, Brendan, and you know some of our listeners may not know what this is, but can you tell us a little bit about PCI compliance?
So PCI compliance is a standardized protocol. It was developed a number of years ago, and it's like that expression, what flows downhill, right? So Congress decided they needed to take steps against identity theft. So they put it to Visa, MasterCard, Discover to create a program, and Amex to create a program to protect against card numbers being stolen and personal data being stolen in a merchant environment. And of course, that got passed down to the processors, and the processors in turn passed that down to the merchant. So basically what PCI is, it's a self-assessment of how you are taking steps in your business to protect against credit card numbers being stolen. So in today's day and age, just because of the technology we spoke about earlier, businesses are really no longer holding on to credit card numbers the way that they used to. You know, several years ago, you'd say, I'll keep my credit card number on file, even at a business like a butcher, and he would just write it down on an index card and it'd be sitting on his desk. So, you know, that index card, that folio could get stolen, and now someone has a batch of credit card numbers to go use until all those cardholders realize their card number's been stolen. So to prevent against things like that, PCI was developed. So we have an online system where right through CardPoint, right through the same place you would log in to both see your transactions, see your statements, run transactions, etc., there's another tab there that's PCI. And depending on the type of business, once a year or once every 6 months, you'd go on and answer the questionnaire and you'd get yourself PCI certified until the next, until your PCI certification was up. It is a standardized process, but the delivery of the questionnaire varies, you know, from one provider to another. So we've tried to make ours, you know, as easy as possible. I mean, it's right in your face every time you log into the portal. You can't really miss it.
Sounds good.
Yep.
What are the common misconceptions of your business? I know there's a lot.
There's a lot. Yeah, there's a lot. The biggest misconception, I would say, is that the merchant themselves thinks that when they're paying 3 or 3.5% in fees, that the merchant representative who comes through their door to set up their account is earning all of that money, is making all of that money. When the reality is, there's a lot of parties involved in moving the money of a credit card transaction. There's the bank behind the credit card processor. There's the credit card processor themselves. There's the bank behind the company who issued the credit card. Then there's Visa, there's MasterCard, whomever. So there's a lot of hands in the cookie jar, so to speak. So that would be the number one misconception about our business. And then the next one is the rates themselves, understanding the pricing and the fees that are involved. There's a lot of misconceptions there. Of, you know, sort of what can be negotiated and what can't be. And, you know, I would say the other thing that people would need to understand is with a credit card transaction, if you're swiping all of your credit cards, your rates would typically be lower than if you're key entering a lot of your credit card transactions. Because in the eyes of the credit card processors, a key entered transaction is more likely that if there's fraud, it will be in a key entered transaction than a swiped. Because a thief would not steal the piece of plastic, the actual card. They're just going to steal the numbers. So they're never swiping it necessarily. So a swipe transaction would be cheaper because it's lower risk. That's a general rule that I think people don't understand.
Tell us a little bit about some of the businesses that you've worked with, you know, what things you've done to help them. Maybe tell us a little story. I think it's sure. time for story time. Yes.
Story time. It's your story time. Well, having been around and in the industry as long as I've been, I've serviced every type of business you can think of. But some of the we approach every time we meet a merchant, we approach it with a very consultative mindset, meaning that we're going to meet them and see the best way to lower what they're paying. So, and perhaps deliver some other more efficiency. So when we work with a company like a home heating oil company, as an example, those companies most often are set up like a mail order business. You know, someone never brings the card to the heating oil company to get a fill up. They pay over the phone. And a lot of processors don't understand that there's different ways to set up businesses. A lot of home heating oil companies pay about 3% in fees, which is a typical number for a business that is almost all key entered. But if you know the business and you know our industry, there's a way to set up a home heating oil company where you actually register the business in a certain way where Visa, MasterCard, and Discover consider that heating oil company to be like a utility, which is much more preferential costs of the credit cards. The cost of credit cards is called interchange. So when we uncover this, we of course approached many of the regional, nationwide, and local oil companies, and we were able to cut their fees by more than half simply by registering their business properly. And it's the sort of thing where if we don't have a consultative approach, we wouldn't, a credit card processor wouldn't necessarily set them up properly. So we look at the holistic consultative approach to the business where we look for the best solution for them, for their specific business type, not just putting them all in a company that is like a mail order business, which is what most of our competition does.
You are listening to Tower Talk Business Radio. Our guest today is Brendan Ivory of CardConnect. My name is Donyshia Boston-Hill, along with Ray Schwetz on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
So what's the accomplishment that you're most proud of? I know that's a tough question, but when you work with so many businesses, but what comes to mind when you think of, you know, the accomplishments that you've made?
You know, on a personal level, just building a happy and prosperous environment for my family and having a real nice workplace in our office. I'm very proud of both of those things. I'm happy to get up and go to work every day, and I'm happy to come home every day. It's just, we're in a good environment. I'm proud of, sort of seeing the writing on the wall. When I first got in the industry, I could see that the general direction of payments was going from cash and check to credit cards. So having a little foresight, there was an organic growth in the business that we saw coming, and we invested ourselves into it. And we've built quite a good practice here on Long Island with a tremendous presence and a sparkling reputation. And I'm proud of that.
And all that work, what do you do to unwind?
I love to surf and I love to fish. I love to play basketball with my son, and I let him beat me every now and again. No, I'm not good at basketball. I can't play basketball to save my life. I never did, but he loves it. So I pretend I know how to play just for him. But now surf and fish is my one and two hobbies, I would say.
Gotcha. And are you, I'm not sure if you're able to do that now with the COVID situation. Now with it opening up, obviously the opportunities are there, but what have you been doing, you know, to kind of keep sane during all of this?
Well, believe it or not, I think like a lot of people, I took on a lot of projects around the house that I had no business taking on. and then I made sure I exercised. I believe it or not, it doesn't sound like something that I would prioritize in this type of environment, but I, as a rule, I worked out the very first thing every single morning, even if it was just for a quick jog. We have a Peloton at the house, which I took advantage of. And I think that really kept me sane. To be honest, I really think that made a big difference. It's just was keeping that discipline.
Yeah, no, it's no COVID-19 for you. And how do you think?
No.
How do you think you've made an impact, you know, with CardConnect and everything that you're doing? What's your purpose?
Our purpose, of course, is to make sure that everybody that we meet with sort of has a fair understanding of what our industry is. I also have a very long-term outlook. There's plenty of people that I'll meet with. If they're in a good place, I'll tell them so. And, you know, if they need any help or have a question down the line or somewhere a year, 2 years, 5 years from now, they're upset with whoever their current provider is, they're going to remember me and call me. So I always like to tell people that, you know, have a long-term outlook. Our business is built on relationships. And if you don't win someone over with your product or service now, just be honest with them and be fair, and they may come around sometime down the line. And that's how our whole practice has been built, is that long-term outlook and a consultative approach and just being honest and fair with every single interaction we put out there.
Put out the good vibes and they'll come back to you, that's for sure.
Exactly, exactly.
What is the one thought that you want to make sure that you leave our listeners with?
I think, you know, the one thing I would tell merchants, people who have a merchant account, is to not ignore their merchant statement. You know, the merchant statement, admittedly, it's designed to confuse. It's designed to have people not really understand what they're paying. But don't be intimidated by it. Look at it. And look at it every time you get one, which is monthly, to see if there's been any changes. Ask questions. And make sure you feel like you're getting a fair deal. If you're not, you know, your phone's ringing off the hook with competition looking to take that business. But I would say the number one thing is to not ignore the merchant statement. Many businesses, they don't understand it, and they get worn down, and they literally just throw them in the garbage. They don't look at them, and that's a mistake.
Now, what would you say would be kind of, so of the top three, that's definitely up there. What are the top three considerations that a business should have when they're considering credit cards?
Of course, everyone is concerned on cost. So I would get, every time you're looking into it, certainly get more than one quote and try and make them the same as best you can. The second thing is, in this day and age, is if you can go contactless. And I would also say for businesses, even small businesses, to invest in technology that will streamline your whole process, because it will save you more money down the line than being sort of penny wise, pound foolish.
So look at those statements.
Look at the statements.
Consider your costs.
Consider your costs and invest in technology when you can.
Invest in technology and keep things contactless. Gotcha, gotcha. Sounds good for me.
Absolutely.
What's next for you and your team?
Well, launching our, you know, our post-COVID marketing, we've been delivering contactless terminals to those of our businesses, those of our merchants who did not have one for whatever the reason. So that's taken up quite a bit of our bandwidth. We've also had a significant number of our businesses convert over from traditional processing to where they pass the fee along to the customer. And really the next move for our team is to go out and see everybody who weren't not able to see us for the last 3 months. You know, it's been quite a bit of time before we've been able to go shake hands with our merchants. And we might not be shaking hands with them now, but maybe we could at least show our faces in their businesses.
Yeah, I think we all miss that, right?
Yeah, it's been a crazy time. And, you know, we're just looking to make sure that if people need us, they know we're here. We haven't gone anywhere.
Speaking of that, what's the best way for you to be contacted?
The number one way, of course, everyone is with the email, bivory@cardconnectpartners.com. So B like Brendan. Ivory is my last name, I-V-R-Y, like the color, @cardconnectpartners.com. And our office number is 877-261-5436. And we're based right in Smithtown, New York, here in Long Island.
Yep. Keeping business on Long Island, honoring small business. So thank you very much, yeah. Brendan.
Appreciate it. Great to meet with you guys and speak with you today. Thanks, Ray. Thanks, Donyshia.
Thank you for joining us.
Great to have you on the show. And, of course, now it's time for DB's philosophy, isn't it?
It's the best partnerships aren't dependent on mere common goal, but on shared path of equality, desire, and no small amount of passion. That's Sarah McLean.
We want to thank you for being with us. My name is Ray Schwetz, along with Donyshia Boston-Hill, your co-host and producers. This is an NCC Foundation Business Leaders Council production. Visit ncc.edu/WHPC for more information. Available on iHeartRadio as a podcast on iTunes, Android Podcasts, and Spreaker. This has been Tower Talk Business Radio, powered by the NASA Community College Foundation on the Voice of NASA Community College, 90.3 WHPC. We'll talk with you next week.